be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. You are good, good. Oh, you are good, good. Oh, you are good.
Hello and welcome to another week, and we start this week with a call to worship and then a prayer. So let us pray. Worship God with gladness, come into his presence and praise his name. Loving Lord, your grace draws us to your presence, your peace unites us in your love, your hope inspires us to praise your glory. May our worship be worthy of you. We come before you, just as we are. We come with our weaknesses and our vulnerabilities. We come with our fears and apprehensions. We come with faith and doubt. We come to offer and receive. We come to you, the King of Love, in the name of your Son and in the power of your Spirit. Amen. And so we're going to have our first two songs, starting with Life Song and then By Faith.
Sacrifice, if not joined with my life, I sing in vain tonight. May the words I say and the things I do make my life song sing, bring a smile. Let my life
see the hand of God. In the light of creation's grand design. In the lives of those who prove His faithfulness. Who walk by faith and not by sight. By faith our fathers roamed the earth.
So let us continue our service with prayer, and then we will have another song called I Am Fearless. So let us pray. We unite with the whole world in praising you, Creator God. We come before you with gladness and thanksgiving. We praise your goodness. We praise your faithfulness. We praise your tenderness. We are yours and we worship you. We bless your name forever. Amen. And so we have our next song called I Am Fearless.
Ahead may be unknown as I brave the unseen road. God, go with me. Every hidden sacrifice through the watches of the night. God, go with me. Through it all I know I am not alone. Sets my heart on what you've done and who you are. God, you're for me. Every heart and heavy step, I will see your faithfulness. God, you are for me, for me. I am fearless in your presence. Midnight hour, you've given me a spirit of power.
No fear in the crashing waves. No fear when the cost is great. No fear in the midnight hour. You've given me a spirit of power.
So we come now to our Bible reading, and this is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 9, verse 35, to chapter 10, verse 23. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and curing every disease and every sickness. When he had saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the labourers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out labourers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew the tax collector, James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Canaan, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment. Take no gold or silver or copper in your belts, no bag for your journey, or two tunics or sandals or a staff, for labourers deserve their food. Whatever town or village you enter, find out who in it is worthy and stay there until you leave. As you enter the house, greet it. If the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not come to you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet as you leave that house or town. Truly I tell you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that town. See, I am sending you out like sheep into the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of them, for they will hand you over to councils and flog you in their synagogues. And you will be dragged before governors and kings because of me, as a testimony to them and the Gentiles. When they hand you over, do not worry about how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given to you at that time. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will betray brother to death, and a father his child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all because of my name. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next. For truly I tell you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. Here in this reading, Jesus sends the apostles to the Israelites to tell them that the kingdom of God has come near. This claim will be supported by their doing the same wondrous deeds as Jesus. They are not to charge for their work, but are to be as dependent as possible on the support of those to whom they go. Some of the instructions seem a bit extreme. Who would go on a journey without sandals or a staff? Since the parallel account in Mark, which is chapter 6, verses 8 to 9, allows both, it seems likely that the sense is for them not to take spares. In a culture where hospitality was hugely important, their situation of dependence would then provoke responses, good or bad, from those to whom they went. The extended reading indicates that some will respond negatively towards the disciples and will face consequences for this on the day of judgment. The teaching goes on to indicate that there will be persecution of those who spread the gospel, and family divisions will result. But the sent ones are to know that the Spirit of their Father will speak through them. This call to tell people that the kingdom has come near doesn't just apply to the apostles in Matthew's gospel, but also to us today. We too are called to action and to tell and show that Jesus lives and God's kingdom is here in us. Whilst we may not face persecution ourselves, there are Christians around the world who do. However, we may be ridiculed for this by our work colleagues or by people who we may meet and talk to on the street. And sometimes it does split friends and family. We ourselves cannot perform the miracles that Jesus and his disciples did, but we can show the love of Jesus to those who we work with and meet in our daily lives. Whether that be meetings on Zoom or Skype or Microsoft Teams, or if we have to go to work, and also our friends and family that we call to speak to at this time of uncertainty, this time of isolation. We're going to hear a conversation, or two conversations, between myself and people that I know, one who's at home isolating, who speaks to their family, and someone who works at a college who is holding meetings via Zoom. So here they are. So Ruth, where will you be this time tomorrow?
I think I shall probably be out in the garden. I've spent a lot of time in the garden over the last couple of weeks. But the thing that remains to be done is, and this covers part of the rest of what you're asking, I've got to get the greenhouse set up and planted with the tomatoes and the cucumbers and that sort of thing. And the weather should be a bit cooler tomorrow, which will make it easier. So gardening.
Yes.
Yeah.
So obviously you've told me what you're doing. So what challenges and joys are you going to take from?
The joy is just, I like gardening. I can spend a lot of time out there, you know, doing bits and pieces or just sitting. The challenges are really all down to my mobility problems, because my knees are bad and have got worse. I was out yesterday and my walking generally is not as good as it was a couple of months ago. And I have to be very careful what I do in the garden, so that I don't trip over and fall. And the thing with the greenhouse is there's a whole lot of stuff that's got to come out. And then I've got to give it a bit of a vacuum to get rid of the spider's webs and that sort of thing. I really ought to wash the glass down. And it all turns into a really big job. And it's quite daunting, really. It's one of those things that you don't look forward to doing it, but when it's done, it's nice, and then you don't have to think about it again till October, but apart from watering. But it's, you know, there's all sorts of seeds growing in trays and pots, and they've all got to be shifted out and put somewhere else temporarily at least. And yeah, so the challenge is, it's how to achieve it all, get it done, and B, do it safely. Without falling over.
So it's a safety point there.
Yes, definitely.
So how can we pray for you in your gardening and setting the greenhouse up?
I think really the prayers are about my mobility, because, you know, I know everything that needs doing, but it's all about what I'm actually physically capable of doing. And as I say, I think my mobility has got worse over the last couple of months, because I haven't been going out and been doing as much. And I have concerns that when we go back to church in a more normal way, the expectation will be that I will go back to doing the things I've always done. And I worry that I'm not going to be able to do that. So I worry that from my own point of view, my world will shrink. And I worry that I'm not going to be able to be there for other people, you know, thinking of things like Wednesday Fellowship and that sort of thing. You know, if we were running Wednesday Fellowship, I'd be thinking about the summer lunch, and you know, that won't happen, obviously, but will we be back for a Christmas lunch? Will I be able to cope with doing a Christmas lunch for 24 people? I don't know. So, yes, I think those are my worries for the future, really, mm-hmm. sort of on a personal level. Okay. It's about, yes, I suppose a loss of independence in many ways. Yeah.
All right. Brilliant. Well, thank you, Ruth, and it's been nice talking to you, discussing these questions. So, thank you.
Okay, thanks.
Cheers. So, Ian, where will you be this time tomorrow?
This time tomorrow, as in Friday tomorrow. All right. Yeah. Well, first of all, I'll be here in my own house, in the hall of my own house, at a desk which is now supposedly a Cliff College desk, and it's been seconded in my little house. From here, I will be doing oodles of conversations with people on Zoom. I'll be doing lots of marking of students, and I'll be dialoguing about the way forward for Cliff College. I start the day, though, with morning prayer. So I'm actually leading morning prayers every Friday morning at Cliff College from this little bit at the end of my hall. So I do my 15 minutes of recorded morning prayers, which is out on the Cliff College Facebook. So my day starts with that, which I think is pretty good. At least I start with prayer before we start then moving into endless Zoom meetings. The next one, of course, is what we call the academic board, is when the teachers, the faculty of the college get together and we decide, and we are having lots of decisions at the moment. How do you run a college? Not just now, but how do you run it in September onwards? And how are we going to support students that are already on courses? How do we invite people onto our courses, which many of which are now going to be online? So there's lots of discussion, as you can imagine, about how we do that. But the conversation in the afternoon is something that's actually pertinent to you, Chris, and that is I'm talking to Bob Bartendale in the afternoon, who heads up the local preachers training, the whole training that you're part of yourself. Mm-hmm. So we're just reflecting on what does it mean to support students who are on the worship leading and preaching course. So yeah, I'll be doing that this afternoon, tomorrow afternoon.
Brilliant. And what joys and challenges are you expecting in your day tomorrow?
Well, I think that I love leading prayers. They take a bit of effort to create, but I do love the idea of leading people in prayer. It's one of my joys at the college. I like the college chapel. It's one of my familiar places in a place that I've worked for 19 years. It's one of my happy places is the chapel, actually. Mm-hmm. So that's always good to encourage people to pray and to start their day like that. So that's a joy. And I think I like the idea of resourcing people, growing people. I always use the analogy that, you know, part of your role as a tutor in a college is to help grow people. You're like a gardener, really. So these are the joys. The challenges, it's all these Zoom meetings. It's all this online stuff, you know, chatting to you today. We've just said it's either my sixth or seventh Zoom meeting of the day. Look at my eyes. They're becoming square like the screen. This is what's happening to us. I'm finding that a challenge.
Yeah, I can imagine. And how can we pray for you in your day tomorrow?
Sanity. I think the rhythm of when you go to a place, like I'm so used to going to work, and many of us are used to going to places, and it gives us a natural rhythm. That's when your coffee break is. That's when you meet your colleagues, you know, that's when you do things, and it chops up the day differently. Mm-hmm. What I'm finding here, and I think many, many of us are finding, is that time kind of blurs a bit. You can be less effective and less efficient. So it's really being able to say, that's work, that's done, I leave that, and now I have something else, which is my life in my own house. And it's getting some clarity to the day. So that's what I pray for, that really ongoing, not just for tomorrow, that actually what we do is say, okay, that's work, and that's that kind of function, and over here is the rest of life, which is really important, not only just because the government guidelines are go out for a walk, but actually that engagement with other people is really important. So yeah, that's what I pray for.
All right, brilliant. Well, thank you, Ian, and we'll speak to you soon.
So thank you again to both Ian and Ruth. And we come now to a time of prayer, to pray for them, to pray for what they will be doing tomorrow. So let us pray. Almighty Father, we pray for Ruth, who will be doing her garden. We pray for her mobility. We pray that she will no longer worry about her mobility problems, and she will know your healing and your love. We pray that in our return to church and in our return to normality, that not too much will be asked of her in her mobility. And we pray that she may see and feel a sense of achievement in the garden that she is creating, the garden, a garden of love, a garden that shows your love, your caring nature towards all things. And we pray for Ian, who is hosting meetings via Zoom daily. As we heard, the one that me and him had in our conversation was his 7th meeting of the day via Zoom. We pray that he may keep some sort of sanity. And not get too zoomed out. We pray that there may be clarity within all our lives, and especially Ian's, who is working from home, who may know clarity between work and home. We pray for all people who are in these situations, people who feel that their mobility is not as good as it once was, who worry for the future. We pray for people who are working from home, who seek clarity between work and home life. Lord, we pray this in your name. Amen.
And so we come now to more prayer. So let us pray. Loving Lord, you call and equip us to serve you. Watch over those who risk their own safety by caring for oppressed believers. Strengthen and protect all those who are persecuted for sharing their faith in places where living out their Christian faith in peace is not allowed. Loving Lord, you empower us to live out our discipleship. Give wisdom, imagination, and the strength to persevere to those who face apathy as they seek to live out their discipleship. Loving Lord, you understand what it means to suffer for what is right. Give comfort and courage to those who are unjustly imprisoned, intimidated, and tortured because of their faith. Loving Lord, you taught us to pray for those who abuse and hurt us. We pray for people who persecute those who hold different beliefs from their own. May they be touched by faith and their hearts be open to love, that the world may be united in your love. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. And so we have one final song.
Fill us up and send us out, Lord. stand beside the broken, we must go stepping forward. Keep us from just singing, move us into action. We must go. Send us out, yeah. Ooh, heaven. Oh,
go to serve, go to love, go to bring healing, go to bring peace. Go in the strength of the Father, go in the power of Jesus, go united by the Spirit, go and know His grace. Amen.